I love cutting wood. I don't know why. I should talk to my therapist about it. In the meantime, we're going to talk about forestry, opportunities and challenges for the bioeconomy, and more specifically in relation to sustainable fashion. Welcome.
If you celebrate Christmas, there is one tree you probably just cut at that time of the year.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful.
Now, I have one question for you. Once Christmas is over, what are you going to do with that tree? Maybe you'd like to turn it into a wood fiber shirt. How cool is that? Think about it. It's a perfect activity to do with the kids on the weekend, especially if they like playing with heavy chemicals and solvents. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Sounds interesting? Here's how to make wood fiber with Audrey Hammer.
First, turn your tree into cellulosic fiber. That's what we do when we want to make paper. We have a video on the episode page that will show you how it's generally done. The problem we are now facing is that the fibers you have just made are only a few millimeters long. Hard to make a t-shirt out of this. Cotton, for instance, is much easier to turn to yarn because it's around 4 centimeters long already. But the paper fibers, you need an extra step. By the way, you should really get the cat off the table. We are going to use a technique called solution spinning. Okay, kids?
Yay! Yay!
Put the fibers into this liquid. It's a solvent. This will dissolve your fibers into a viscous substance. What's the next step? Extruding your substance into another liquid, but with this new liquid, your cellulose is not soluble. Magic, magic! Your substance is going to coagulate into fibers. Now you just need to wash them, dry them, and cut them. You finally obtained a 40 millimeter long fibers. Voila!
Hey, sweetie, are you okay? All right, drink some water. You'll feel better soon. That's right. Okay, I guess you got the message. The process used until today is not quite environment friendly. Everyone agrees, it's no secret. Should we give up? Absolutely not. There is promising research underway. In a world where cotton production is reaching its limits, in a world where the demand for fibers is going to keep increasing as population grows, we really need to figure this out. Can sustainable forestry practices support the textile sector? And if yes, how? You're listening to The Green Exchange, episode 2 of our series about bioeconomy and sustainable fashion. From wood fire to wood fibers, can we hope for a more sustainable future for forestry? First, what does all this have to do with fire? Well, besides providing wood pulp to the paper industry, biomass is typically interesting for producing heat. And at least in Northern Europe, it's a hot topic on the agenda. We're hoping to dig deeper in an upcoming series of The Green Exchange, but for now, it's enough to say that 1. Burning biomass is currently considered as slow renewable energy, since it takes at least 80 to 100 years for the resource wood to be replenished. This means it qualifies for tax credits, subsidies, and incentives in many countries. And many environmentalists and experts don't like this. And they're probably right. 2, because today, we know how to get hot water from greener sources than waste and biomass. We'll talk about it. And 3, the value we could create from each ton of wood harvested could be much, 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 much higher than the value of wood as a fuel, if we turn it into fibers, for instance. It's exactly the same thinking as in episode 1, where we talked about turning waste fish skin into leather as a much higher value alternative than producing fish meal. So, moving from wood fire to wood fibers, question 1, Can we create much higher value for each ton of wood we have on our hands? Question 2. Can we do this in a way that significantly reduces the amount of carbon we put into the atmosphere in comparison to burning biomass? Question 3. Can we use fiber production processes that are truly respectful of the environment? I don't like this whole idea of dumping chemicals everywhere. Do you? Question 4. Can those fibers last? Can they be reused and recycled so we enter a closed-loop system? In short, can we say our forestry sector has greener days ahead? And if not green, what color should our forests be? On the textile front now, well, you've probably heard the story. The global textile production is expected to increase threefold to reach 240 million tons per year by 2050. At the same time, the world production of cotton is considered to have reached its limit and is starting to seriously compete with food production. The cotton production is also associated with water scarcity, high use of fertilizer and hazardous pesticides, loss of habitat and soil degradation. So, long story short, additional sources of textile fibers are needed to face the emerging environmental issues related to climate change, to water management and food security. So again, my friends, please, 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 this series about bioeconomy and sustainable fashion is important. Let's share it far and wide, because we need to make some noise about those issues. Talk about cotton and wood fibers next time you're having dinner with friends, or at the Christmas dinner.
Mommy, 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 can we open the presents?
Not yet, sweetie. First, we need to talk about cellulosic fiber with Uncle Jim. All right, let's start digging. First, let's take a look at where our forests spread in Europe. We have my colleague Josh on the line. Hi, Josh.
Hey, Camille. Good to be here, mate.
Good to have you. We discussed sending you on a space shuttle to take a couple of pictures and see exactly where most forests are. But I understand we were a bit tight in terms of budget.
Yeah, look, I mean, I thought space travel got a lot cheaper since Elon Musk and SpaceX started launching rockets daily into the stratosphere. But look, I spoke to Elon and he really couldn't come up with a good deal for us on this one. And, you know, I spoke to the guys at NASA and they're all out of money themselves. So, yeah, had to find other solutions here.
That was unexpected. What's plan B?
Yeah, so I thought I'd go on Google Maps instead. And, well, it's not as fancy, but...
All right, let's do with what we have. So tell me.
Well, basically, most forest density is in the north, as you can imagine. We put a map in the complementary resources section for everyone who wants to go and check it out themselves. Finland comes in at 72% of the land area. It's covered mostly by forest itself, and Sweden is at about 58%. Then, you know, wait, let me just scroll down with Google. So yeah, so then around the Alps, you can see some serious density. Austria, France, Germany, and Central Europe is also doing okay.
Okay, so it's a very significant industry. I guess that gives us a good idea of where the potential is for cellulosic fibers production.
Yeah, the action is really happening in Sweden, Finland, Norway, and Austria, in fact. And look, 7 out of 10 of the biggest European paper companies are in those four countries. And the largest pulp producers are Finland and Sweden, with around 12 megatons per year. Actually, each produce double amount of wood pulp for paper than what Russia produces. And this is UN data, more than what Russia produces. And Sweden and Finland combined produce more than China.
Okay.
Now, here's the thing. Transportation has become so cheap that it's quite easy to get materials processed for a much lower cost in another country, and you get an end product back in another form.
Yeah, I see where you're going with this. So if there was a process that you need to run as part of your operations, a process that is chemical intensive and very expensive to control in Europe, where you actually need to treat the chemicals and do things properly?
Look, I'd do it in China, and I'd bring it back to Europe afterwards.
Smart, Josh, smart. Hey, listeners, sounds familiar? Yeah, that's what is happening with viscose production today. Let's talk about alternatives to this crazy practice. Thanks for passing by, Josh. I hope we can send you into space very soon.
Ciao.
Before we keep going with our investigation, I would like to thank the Nordic Council of Ministers for helping make this episode possible.
Fire and ice colliding.
They are the official body for Nordic Intergovernmental Cooperation and are of course quite active on the issues we're discussing in this series.
Too mild and too warm.
I had the chance to host a discussion with our General Secretary, Dagfinn Hoybråten, as well as with the Swedish Minister of Rural Affairs, Sven-Erik Bucht. And of course, we talked about the future of forestry, biomaterials, and sustainable fashion. Here are a couple of highlights from their comments, introducing the debate.
So I think what we're focusing much in the Nordic region is, you know, lobbying for better EU regulations on harmful chemicals. That's high on the environmental agenda of the Nordic countries. Call for supplier requirements on the supplier side for sustainable textiles. And this together is actually creating opportunities for innovation and later on commercial developments. I think there is one aspect of the crossroads of public and private sector and the research sector that is often overlooked in the public debate.
Right.
And that is the effect that regulation can have on creating business opportunities and together with innovation, there is actually a huge market when regulators move in and decide some standards or regulate some demands or even prohibit some material.
Yes.
We have our tradition of world-leading innovation, and we have a lot of trees. A lot of trees. The old production of viscose was not green or sustainable, but new developments look very promising.
This is where we should stop for a few minutes, because those new developments could unleash the whole sector. Let's talk about this. The polluting methods we described earlier are 100 years old. The solvents are rare, and obviously the processes we have been using in this industry are not environmentally sound. Most of it is done in Asia. But more recently, research and innovation efforts have started to look at new solvents for cellulose and viable alternatives for industry. Conclusive? Well, not yet, but rather encouraging, it seems.
The research in cellulose solvents has really exploded the last 10 years.
This is Tobias Köhnke from Cellutex. It's an advocacy platform which is basically trying to promote and ensure the production of cellulose-based textiles in Europe, also participating in our live talk show in Stockholm in November.
Right.
And we have to take care of that fundamental research and lift it up to applied research as well, to develop these new processes. And for that, we need test facilities and test beds and so on, which we don't really have.
So more fundamental research primarily, more applied research, more testing. And of course, this implies more innovation money.
Money!
If you want to know more about what specific activities need support, we are publishing a few links on the episode page that will give you the full picture. Just connect to our website, greenexchange.se, click on the series Bioeconomy and Sustainable Fashion, and hopefully our resources section will make you happy. One more thing on research.
Point on that, we're looking at fibers, which is really important, but we need to look at throughout the whole life cycle assessment.
This point was made by Sigrid Barnekow, who is the director at the Swedish research program MISTRA Future Fashion.
Analyze a new fiber, for instance, you need to then assess how it will work in the production and how it will work when you use it and then recycling. So not, so a fiber can at first glance look really good, right? But then if you look at the effects throughout the whole life cycle, it can be a totally different story. And today we lack those type of data. We don't have sufficient data actually on the existing fibers either, because you have done assumptions in the assessment sometimes some years ago that still hangs around. So yeah, we need to advance and progress when it comes to having scientific data that proves that this is to be sustainable, the fiber is sustainable, the process is sustainable, and so on.
And yes, you remember, we've talked about this earlier in the series, in the first episode, when discussing the potential of fish leather.
Remember.
This brings us to our last point for today. Let's say we wake up in a few years and we can put cellulosic fibers on the market in a sustainable way. We found a magic recipe for a solvent. A solvent that is so clean you could even drink it. Do we solve everything with this new solvent? Well, actually, we'd probably dissolve everything with a solvent. What I mean is everything solved, but not with the solvent itself? Yeah. Do we dissolve the situation? Ah!
Have we solved the situation?
Have we solved the situation? That's it. Thank you.
I'm good for nothing, babe. I fail in vain.
Well, let me ask this. What happens to those fibers once they are on the market?
We need also to look at the rest of the life cycle. We need to look at the production, we need to look at how we use our clothes to prolong our clothes, the lifetime of our clothes.
Lifetime. Let's focus on this, shall we? Exactly like cotton, cellulosic fibers are very difficult to recycle. Actually, if you want to sound smart at the next meeting or coffee break, you can say something like, well, you know, fibers in general, they make it hard to close the loop, right? Because they degrade. Okay, so how do we solve this? How do we solve this degradation issue? Personally, I see only three solutions.
All revolutions are impossible till they happen. Then they become inevitable.
Either we make them so environment friendly that we can compost them. Yes, composting it, so we can return this carbon to the soil. That's closing the loop. Now, we're already struggling to put systems in place so we can properly compost our food and create clean closed loops. But why not? Sell it to me. Sure. Second solution? Well, recycling them, I guess. We can turn those fibers into another type of material to supply another sector, as long as we are not creating another problem or transferring the problem to another sector. Third solution, if you make those fibers really tasty and clean for the human body, well, we could eat it. You think I'm kidding? Well, I guess we'll find out. Regardless, one fundamental idea here is that we need to paint on the wall of all the manufacturers in the world. Design for longevity. Design for longevity. That's the best thing we can do right now to limit the impact of this industry and the impact of our fancy lifestyles that, of course, we don't want to sacrifice. And we need to make brands feel guilty of not designing products for longevity. Brands, this song is for you. Goes against the model they have built their business on until today, which is basically making cheap stuff in Asia that will break down or degrade very soon. Shame on you, brands, and shame on us for buying it. If we keep the same design philosophy as today and keep stimulating the same consumption patterns, you can make any kind of sustainable fiber mainstream. It will not solve it. It's just one part of the equation. Now, the good news is, when you start designing for longevity at the same time as you are shifting your business model, moving towards product as a service, for instance, Well, you can actually see strong economic incentives and more growth potential. And you know what? We're going to look at how this specifically applies to the textile sector in our circular economy series. And we will tell all the secrets. The best way to stay posted on this is to click the subscribe button on your podcast app. It's time to close this episode. We're not done talking about this, but the insights we shared today are fundamental to steer development efforts into the right direction. At the end of our live talk show last month in Stockholm, we concluded on the need to strengthen collaboration between the forestry and fashion sectors. Everyone seems to agree. We could also feel that everyone was enthusiastic and optimistic in the closing remarks. Here, for instance, was Dagfinn Hoybråten, Secretary General of the Nordic Council of Ministers.
We can come together, the research, innovation part, the business people, and the public sector. I think we can really be strong. I'm hopeful. I think the potential is there, and there are so many good forces that can work together to make this happen.
So, from wood fire to wood fibers, are we there yet? Not really, but it's definitely a hot topic with encouraging perspectives, and we will keep you posted, of course. I've only one itch in his eye. Let me stand next to your fire. Let us know your questions, info@greenexchange.se, or on Facebook, or on Twitter, or send a pigeon or something. We wish you a Merry Christmas, or whatever you're celebrating. Quality time with family and friends, and please don't forget to compost your Christmas tree and make sure it doesn't end up in an incinerator. It matters. Back soon with more green knowledge, inspiration, and entertainment. Keep up the good work in the meantime. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Jack Frost nipping at your nose. Yuletide carols being sung by a choir, and folks dressed up like Eskimos.